Chers amis, chers collègues, bienvenue à cette dernière séance parallèle du symposium platonicon, l'avant-septième, que j'ai l'honneur de présider. Dans la mesure où, entre les orateurs de cette séance, nous avons un anglophone, un hispanophone, une lusophone et moi, que je suis un italophone, donc j'ai pensé de trancher et de faire ma présentation en français. Bon, peut-être en allemand aussi, mais je n'aurais pas été capable de le faire. Donc, je tiens particulièrement à remercier Gabriele Cornelli et à remercier son staff pour l'organisation. Je remercie aussi beaucoup Gabriele Cornelli pour m'avoir confié cette présidence de cette dernière séance parallèle. Je pensais que son choix constitue d'une quelque façon la volonté d'établir un pont entre le symposium de Pise du banquet, donc, à l'organisation duquel j'ai participé, donc le prochain symposium qui aura lieu, notamment en France, qui est le lieu où je travaille. Donc, je commence tout de suite par vous présenter José Antonio Jiménez, qui est professeur associé adjoint à la Pontificia Universidad Católica de Chile et aussi le chercheur du postdoc du Fonds des sites du Chili, avec un projet de 3 ans sur le thème plaisir, bonheur et politique dans les lois de Platon. Après avoir étudié surtout les rapports entre Platon et Gadamer, on a un article dans la Revista de Philosophia, il a conduit ses recherches pour la thèse de doctorat en philosophie et philologie grecque dans la Westfälische Wilhelms-Universität de Münster, grâce à un financement du gouvernement du Chili et du DAD. Sa thèse doctorale s'intitule Theorie und Praxis bei Platon, die Ethik des gemischten Lebens in Platons Philebos, qui va être publiée le mois de septembre dans la collection de l'International Plato Studies, donc notre collection, et il s'agira donc notamment du volume 36. Je voudrais aussi rappeler un article très intéressant qui apparaît sur la revue Eidos concernant donc, Platon et Damasius à propos donc des plaisirs intellectuels qui, je pense, être en relation avec son travail de thèse. Je lui donne tout de suite la parole. Merci.
Muchas gracias por la presentación. Voy a hablar español. La versión que encuentran en el Book of Papers está un poco cambiada. Voy a presentar la nueva versión. La conversación entre Sócrates y sus amigos el día de su muerte puede entenderse como el intento del maestro de vencer con argumentos el desánimo y el temor de sus discípulos, haciéndoles participar de su actitud confiada y de la esperanza en que la muerte es un bien para el hombre. En vez de concentrarme en los argumentos de Sócrates a favor de la inmortalidad del alma, quisiera analizar en este trabajo el papel que cumplen las disposiciones afectivas de Sócrates y sus interlocutores con respecto a la pregunta por el destino del alma después de la muerte. En mi opinión, la posibilidad de que Sócrates logre hacer participar a su auditorio de su actitud confiada y de su esperanza frente a la muerte no depende exclusivamente de la fuerza persuasiva de sus argumentos a favor de la inmortalidad del alma, sino también de que los amigos de Sócrates experimenten en sí mismos una atracción por la sabiduría, a saber, por el estado del alma cuando ésta está sola en sí misma. Si bien en el Fedón no encontramos una tematización de las disposiciones afectivas de la confianza, la esperanza y el temor, Zaros, Elpis, Fobos, Estos conceptos son utilizados una y otra vez a lo largo del diálogo para explicar la posible relación afectiva del hombre con el acontecimiento de la muerte. En diálogos posteriores como el Fileo y las leyes, estas disposiciones son tematizadas como formas de placer y dolor que se fundan en determinados estados de creencia acerca del futuro. Quisiera en esta conferencia analizar el tratamiento de estas disposiciones afectivas en el Fedón a partir de la descripción de las expectativas del Fileo y las leyes. Luego intentaré responder a tres cuestiones relativas al Fedón. Primero, ¿a qué hace realmente referencia la esperanza socrática? Dos, ¿qué factores determinan el carácter de verdad de esta esperanza? Y tres, ¿qué función práctica o motivacional cumple esta disposición afectiva a lo largo del diálogo? Las expectativas en el Fileo. Encontramos una primera descripción de estas disposiciones afectivas en Fileo 32b9-c6. Los placeres mentales corresponden a una especie diferente de placer que aquellos que se fundan en la reflexión de un vacío fisiológico. Un placer fisiológico es experimentado cuando actualmente el estado de necesidad corporal está siendo dejado de lado. El placer mental no depende, en cambio, de la represión actual del cuerpo, sino que más bien es originado por un contenido mental o expectativa, prostokema. El sujeto puede gozarse y confiarse anticipadamente en la mera perspectiva de un placer futuro, mientras que se atemoriza y apena por anticipado la perspectiva de un sufrimiento futuro. La esperanza y el temor son así dos formas de placer, dolor anticipatorio o de expectativas. En la discusión sobre la falsedad y la verdad de los placeres encontramos otras pistas para entender la naturaleza de los placeres de expectativas. Las opiniones y representaciones falsas o verdaderas son por los hombres usadas en relación al futuro a modo de expectativas. Las esperanzas, es decir, los placeres mentales que se refieren a la obtención de un placer futuro, dependen de los discursos que han sido generados por las opiniones alcanzadas previamente por la percepción. Las esperanzas serán falsas si el razonamiento falla en prever que el estado futuro del sujeto será efectivamente placentero. Las opiniones que han surgido de la percepción son usadas en este caso para prever el futuro, sin ser ellas mismas el contenido de las esperanzas futuras. La experiencia presente de placer deja, sin embargo, al sujeto predispuesto a esperar del futuro la misma satisfacción, y más aún en la medida en que la momentaneidad del placer vuelve a dejar al sujeto en el estado de necesidad y de apetencia previos. Por esta razón, Sócrates considerará necesario reconocer en la producción de esperanzas verdaderas y falsas la importancia de la disposición moral del sujeto. Podemos sacar dos conclusiones fundamentales de este pasaje. En primer lugar, Sócrates conecta la moralidad del sujeto con la ilusión acerca del placer futuro. La enormidad de los placeres pintados en el sujeto impide tanto prever cuáles son las posibilidades realistas de obtenerlo como reconocer las necesidades fundamentales del alma humana. En segundo lugar, la referencia de las esperanzas a la contingencia futura impide alcanzar certeza absoluta sobre ellas. Sin embargo, en la medida en que el bueno sabrá cómo lidiar con el fracaso de sus expectativas, podrá garantizar tener esperanzas que a largo plazo sean confirmadas. Veamos ahora el temor y la confianza en las leyes. Me concentraré en la imagen de la marioneta. El extranjero ateniense introduce la imagen de la marioneta tras haber enumerado los factores motivacionales, los factores motivacionales que se encuentran en cada individuo. En el nivel más básico coexisten en nosotros dos consejeros insensatos, a saber, el placer y el dolor. A partir de estos estados afectivos se generan en nosotros opiniones que, al ser referidas al futuro, reciben el nombre de esperanza o anticipación. El temor consiste en una expectativa dolorosa, mientras que la confianza, zaros, nace de una placentera. Por encima de estos cuatro factores se encuentra el razonamiento, logismos, acerca de lo que es mejor o peor en cada situación. Ahora bien, para entender la interacción de estos factores, el extranjero ateniense nos propone pensar en el hombre como una marioneta divina compuesta de cuerdas o tendones cuya fuerza no controlamos del todo. En este set de cuerdas podemos distinguir una cuerda de oro de un conjunto de cuerdas de hierro. La de oro, correspondiente al razonamiento, es débil y suave, mientras que las demás cuerdas, correspondientes a las afecciones en general, son duras y luchan unas con otras. Ahora bien, si estas cuerdas constituyen una misma especie, ¿qué puede explicar la contrariedad interna entre ellas? El extranjero ateniense sugiere la adición de un tercer set de cuerdas, probablemente de plata, que podría auxiliar a la cuerda de oro a conducir al mecanismo interno de la marioneta. Sin embargo, la decisión final de mantener solo dos especies de cuerda da razón de la necesidad de que en el mecanismo interno del set de cuerdas de hierro exista ya una oposición que pueda ser favorable al razonamiento. Esta interpretación es avalada por la posterior referencia al temor y a la confianza en la formación de la virtud ciudadana. El temor, por una parte, es considerado como una fuerza motivacional negativa cuando consiste en la huida frente al dolor futuro. En este caso, temor y confianza se oponen uno al otro. El temor, sin embargo, puede nacer de un impulso contrario, a saber, la vergüenza. En este caso, el temor puede oponerse precisamente a la aversión del dolor presente, impidiendo así que el dolor anticipado tenga alguna vez lugar. Temor y confianza son, en este sentido, impulsos opuestos, pero que pueden complementarse cuando buscan el mismo objetivo, por ejemplo, vencer al enemigo. Por otra parte, la confianza no siempre es proporcionada, siendo susceptible de volverse en determinados casos de vergüenza. Vamos ahora al Fedón. A continuación intentaré responder a las tres cuestiones planteadas en la introducción acerca del papel de las esperanzas en el Fedón. La primera dificultad consiste en determinar adecuadamente el objeto de la esperanza socrática. En los pasajes revisados de Fileo y las leyes, las expectativas se circunscriben al ámbito de la contingencia humana. En la medida en que estas no se refieren a lo que siempre es, sino tan solo a lo que será, dependen epistemológicamente de opiniones y representaciones que se fundan en su origen en ciertas experiencias de placer y dolor, y que éstas lleguen a ser confirmadas o no dependerá en parte de la praxis humana, de lo que hagamos o no hagamos. Salta a la vista la dificultad que trae la aplicación de esta concepción de la esperanza a la situación del Fedón. Si sostenemos sin más que el objeto de la esperanza socrática es que el alma sea inmortal, no parecería posible ascribir a esta esperanza las características señaladas. La tesis de la inmortalidad del alma, primero, no se refiere a un acontecimiento futuro, dado que la inmortalidad sería una propiedad intrínseca tanto del alma encarnada como separada. Segundo, no contamos con una representación afectiva del alma no encarnada que nos permita gustar anticipatoriamente de la inmortalidad. Tercero, no depende de la praxis humana satisfacer esta esperanza, puesto que tanto el alma del bueno como el alma del malo serían igualmente inmortales. Una lectura más detenida del Fedón nos muestra, sin embargo, que la esperanza socrática no se refiere sin más a la tesis de la inmortalidad. Cuando Sócrates comunica a sus amigos su creencia en la inmortalidad del alma, lo hace a modo de explicación de su estado de ánimo confiado, placentero, ante una situación que despierta en los demás presentes un estado de ánimo contrario. Esta confianza no se funda en otra cosa que la esperanza en que la muerte no puede traer nada malo al hombre bueno. Como en Apología, Sócrates fundamenta su esperanza en una creencia antigua de orden religioso, a saber, que los dioses cuidan del hombre bueno. A pesar de contar con una justificación tradicional de la esperanza en el destino post-mortem, Sócrates decide presentarle a sus discípulos criterios más seguros de justificación de su actitud. Cito 63:7, 64:2. Pero a ustedes, los jueces, quiero darles ahora la debida explicación, ton logon, de por qué me parece verosímil e icotos que un hombre que realmente ha dedicado su vida a la filosofía, anerto ontien filosofía diatripsas ton bion, se muestre confiado, tarrein, cuando está a punto de enfrentar la muerte, melon apostaneisai, y esté bien esperanzado, eu elpis, de que allá obtendrá los mayores bienes una vez que haya muerto. Meista oitestai agasá epeidan teleutese. La filosofía es un ejercicio para morir, puesto que la muerte no consiste en otra cosa que la separación de alma y cuerpo, de modo que cada uno de estos queda librado a sí mismo. Podemos reconstruir de la siguiente manera el razonamiento socrático. Primero, la ocupación del filósofo encarnado consiste en volverse hacia su alma. Segundo, dado que en la muerte el alma queda liberada a sí misma, el estado post-mortem es el óptimo para la actividad filosófica. Tercero, si el estado del alma sola en sí misma es óptimo, debe quererse ante todo su inmortalidad, un argumento que está en Simposio, también en Feder. Así, el filósofo espera que el alma permanezca eternamente tras la muerte. La confianza del filósofo se funda así en dos supuestos. Primero, un estado donde el alma exista sola en sí misma es algo bueno y elegible. Y segundo, que solo el que se ha ejercitado en el arte de morir, liberándose en la medida de lo posible de las pasiones del cuerpo, puede esperar un mayor bien de la muerte. O sea, no cualquiera puede esperar un bien de la muerte. Podemos concluir entonces que la esperanza socrática se refiere a la creencia de que la muerte próxima traerá consigo un bien para aquel que se haya ejercitado en la filosofía. La pregunta que ahora nos compete es la evaluación del valor de verdad que podemos atribuir a esta actitud socrática. Un primer paso en esta evaluación es el enfrentamiento que propone Sócrates entre esperanza y temor a la muerte. Para esto me centro en los pasajes 68C, 69A y 81B a 83C. En el primero, Sócrates opone a los amantes de la sabiduría, filósofoi, que son amantes del alma, aquel que vive apegado a lo corporal, filosómatos. A esta oposición le corresponden disposiciones afectivas contrapuestas frente a la muerte. En este contexto argumentativo es indiferente si el amante del cuerpo cree o no en la inmortalidad del alma, en la medida en que si no reconoce ningún beneficio en la obtención de los bienes propios del alma encarnada, tampoco verá bondad alguna en la existencia separada del alma sin el cuerpo. Frente a la esperanza socrática se contrapone la actitud hedonista de temor al dolor. Este temor se funda en la convicción de que la muerte se encuentra entre los peores males, en la medida en que significa la supresión de todo posible placer del cuerpo y sobreviene ciertamente después de enfermedades o violencias. Es digno de notar que Sócrates refiere aquí a solo tres estados afectivos, a saber, hedoné, lipe y phobos, sin hacer mención alguna de un placer anticipatorio con respecto al futuro. La confianza socrática constituye así el cuarto pasos del fedón. En principio, a diferencia de los otros pasés, uno que no te clava al cuerpo, sino que te libera de su influencia. La creencia del amante del cuerpo con respecto a la muerte es consecuencia de una representación hedonista del futuro. En 81b a e, describe Sócrates cómo las almas de los amantes del cuerpo tienen una representación temerosa del Hades y de lo invisible, en la medida en que anticipan a lo invisible imágenes corpóreas, a saber, fantasmas. El amante del cuerpo continúa, Sócrates, se comporta como un prisionero que a su vez es su propio cómplice o carcelero. En esto se muestra precisamente la disposición engañosa frente al futuro del fileo. El hedonista no puede esperar gustoso la inmortalidad del alma en la medida en que ha reducido su campo de expectativas al ámbito de lo corpóreo. La visión materialista de la vida post-mortem es solo una consecuencia de la fuerza del deseo de placer y la huida de dolor impresa en las representaciones que el sujeto anticipa del futuro. Un segundo paso en la evaluación de la rectitud de la esperanza socrática podemos llevarlo a cabo a la luz del pasaje de la misología. La oposición entre temor y esperanza no ha mostrado todavía que la esperanza a la inmortalidad sea la adecuada, sino tan solo que, al menos en esta disposición, la anticipación esperanzada del futuro no está contaminada por el apego al placer presente. Sócrates introducirá de esta manera una distinción entre una esperanza justificada y una que no lo es. Frente a las réplicas de Simias y Cebes, Sócrates precava la audiencia de caer el sentimiento en misología. Así como la misantropía es un sentimiento adquirido después de haber sido defraudado por los hombres al haber puesto en ellos demasiada confianza, producto de una falta de conocimiento de la naturaleza humana, el odio a los argumentos es el resultado del fracaso de expectativas injustificadas en la búsqueda de la verdad. El misólogo desprecia el acceso racional a la verdad, por decirlo así, por causa de haberse entregado demasiado a él, por la pena experimentada. La genealogía dada por Sócrates del escéptico o misólogo nos permite distinguir tipos de esperanza. La actitud escéptica se cierra a la posibilidad de ser convencido por la verdad en la medida en que la investigación racional padece para ellos de una enfermedad endémica. La actitud socrática, en cambio, considera que la enfermedad afecta antes que a la investigación racional al sujeto que investiga. El sujeto puede mantener entonces la esperanza de sanarse y poder desarrollar los argumentos, como es debido, para ser efectivamente persuadido por la verdad. Sócrates confirma poseer esta disposición al aceptar la posibilidad de no convencer ni a la audiencia ni a sí mismo, y de esta manera manifiesta que no padece del tipo de expectativas desmesuradas e injustificadas que conducen al fracaso de expectativas del escéptico. ¿Cuánto tiempo voy a soltarme esto? Finalmente quisiera brevemente referirme a la función dramática que juega la disposición esperanzada y confiada de Sócrates a lo largo del diálogo. La actitud confiada de Sócrates se funda, como hemos visto, en la expectativa de que el estado del alma en sí misma es deseable para el filósofo, dado que éste espera poder ejercitar las actividades propias del alma, espera también que ésta sea inmortal. De esta manera, la expectativa inicial de Sócrates puede ser reformulada como una que se funda en la creencia en la inmortalidad del alma y en la posibilidad de que el hombre pueda acceder a esta verdad. Sócrates intenta oponer de distinta manera su actitud confiada al enfrentar la hora de la muerte a la tristeza de sus amigos. La tristeza con respecto a la muerte del maestro no sería posible sin el temor por la muerte propia. Paradójicamente, si se considera el ascetismo defendido por Sócrates a lo largo del diálogo, la intención del maestro no es otra que producir alegría y placer en el espíritu de su auditorio. Este placer es producido evidentemente por la comunicación de la esperanza de que la muerte no puede ser un mal para el hombre bueno. Sin embargo, hay otro mecanismo que utiliza Sócrates para aliviar la tristeza de sus discípulos. La misma controversia, la misma conversación, es para todos los presentes motivo de placer intelectual, o al menos de compensación frente a la tristeza ante el destino del maestro. Así se puede entender la experiencia que Fedón le comunica a Equécrates en la conversación con la que se abre el diálogo. Durante la conversación, a él y a los demás los embargaba un sentimiento mezclado de dolor y placer. Dolor por la muerte del maestro, placer por su actitud y su conversación. En mi opinión, estos dos tipos de placer han de entenderse en relación uno con otro. El placer anticipatorio en la inmortalidad del alma supone el conocimiento previo de aquella actividad que puede realizar el hombre cuando está solo con su alma. Esto es la actividad intelectual. Sócrates busca así, a través de su conversación, producir en sus discípulos aquel estado que anhela precisamente el filósofo, incubando en ellos también el anhelo y la esperanza de la inmortalidad. La esperanza en la inmortalidad del alma se presenta en este sentido como una fuerza motivacional suficiente para oponerse a la actitud hedonista. Si bien en el Fedón no encontramos una distinción entre partes del alma, la función de la esperanza y la confianza encargadas en la figura de Sócrates cumplen en parte la función del apetito irascible en diálogos posteriores.
Je remercie beaucoup José Antonio Jiménez pour cette étude des passions dans le Fédon à partir d'une analyse très pointue des parties étudiées donc dans le cadre des dialogues tardifs. Donc je pense qu'il y aura de nombreuses questions sur ce sujet suite à cette intervention très passionnante. Professeur Velázquez.
Voy a elevar el tono entonces, no me cuesta un poco, pero creo que aquí hay una base muy interesante que se puede desarrollar ricamente hacia el futuro también, incluso pensando en lo siguiente, que de alguna manera la esperanza, el PIS supongo que es lo que tú has pensado un poco, que esperanza y fe, entre las dos cosas, hay un elemento que me parece importante de revisar en el futuro griego, porque el futuro griego es muy raro, no raro, sino que se ve que el futuro griego proviene de un desiderativo, por decir así, indoeuropeo o proto-indoeuropeo, que aparentemente el futuro, más que un futuro temporal, es un futuro de tipo desiderativo, subjuntivo de alguna manera, y ese elemento de deseo, de alguna manera está presente la idea de que el futuro viene hacia mí, en el sentido que la muerte, claro, uno, la muerte viene, en algún momento viene a nosotros y nosotros vamos a la muerte. Es decir, de alguna manera, la idea de la muerte incluye dos movimientos, ¿verdad? Y hace que cuando hablemos de esperanza, me parece que tú de alguna manera has tomado esos elementos, al ver el elemento de deseo hacia el futuro, puesto que de algún modo hay ese doble movimiento del alma que va hacia y de la cosa que viene hacia mí. Entonces yo creo que se me ocurre una sugerencia solamente, aprovechar de alguna manera esos elementos del futuro griego, de la temporalidad griega, para enriquecer aún más un trabajo que me parece muy bueno.
Muchas gracias, profesor Velázquez. Me parece muy interesante el análisis del uso del futuro en griego. Yo creo que la diferencia entre deseo y esperanza es que la esperanza tiene que ver, o sea, el uso que hace Platón de esperanza da lugar a una praxis, porque la esperanza, o sea, tener esperanza en algo es tener un deseo posible, tiene que ver con algo que es posible y que está en la praxis humana poder satisfacer. Yo veo ese es el elemento, por eso yo veo en la esperanza en Platón un elemento que puede anticipar el uso de la praxis aristotélica en algunos puntos.
Merci. Est-ce qu'il y a des autres questions? Alors peut-être je peux poser moi une petite question à Antonio, à José Antonio. Est-ce que tu pourrais revenir dans ton... Can you, I want to ask you something about this topic. Your analysis of Pate in the Phaedo was very interesting in order to, with this relationship with the Philebus and the Laws. Do you think that your analysis can help us to understand some of the literary pattern of the narration in the Phaedo? For example, the reflection about the comical and tragical aspect in the Philebus. Do you think that you can use this analysis in order to analyze to the literary structure of the
Yo creo que es posible, pero no lo he pensado bien. Yo creo que es posible una conclusión que yo saco de este trabajo es que dentro de el objetivo literario del diálogo es que los discípulos, que los filoi de Sócrates se sientan como Sócrates, y eso se logra por fundamentación pero también por mímesis, o sea, mímesis o que experimenten el placer intelectual, porque si no experimento el placer intelectual no puedo tampoco querer que el alma sea inmortal, no puedo ni siquiera preocuparme por eso. Entonces esa experiencia, ahora el placer intelectual, o sea, esa representación del placer intelectual del alma encarnada no será lo mismo, pero a partir de eso yo puedo motivarme a buscar eso que no conozco y de lo que no tengo experiencia.
Muchas gracias. Est-ce qu'il y a d'autres questions? Donc s'il n'y a pas d'autres questions, après avoir donc remercié José Antonio Jiménez. Thank you. je voudrais, bon, j'ai le plaisir d'introduire Carolina Araújo. Je commence quand même à l'introduire. Donc, Carolina. Et donc, Carolina Araújo est professeure de philosophie à l'Université du Fédéral de Rio de Janeiro et elle est aussi chercheure au Conseil national de pesquisa du Brésil. Elle est aussi présidente adjointe de la Société latino-américaine de philosophie ancienne. Ses travaux concernent surtout la métaphysique de Platon, sa pensée philosophique et plus en général la philosophie de l'action. Elle a écrit de nombreux articles concernant Platon. Je peux vous citer par exemple The Definition of Dynamis in Republic 5 and its Argumentative Rule, mais il y a aussi des articles concernés, par exemple les bias mineurs. Elle a écrit une monographie, Da Arte, Uma Leitura do Gorgias de Platon, et elle est aussi, elle a dirigé donc un mélange Verdade e Spettacolo, Platon et Apostol du Cerf, qui vient de sortir. Je voudrais aussi vous citer le rapport national concernant la participation des femmes à la philosophie au Brésil, qu'elle vient de rédiger pour l'Association nationale de post-graduation en philosophie. Donc je lui donne tout de suite la parole. Merci Carolina. Pour Plato Sfido on Rational Soicism.
Grazie, Michele. Can you hear me?
Yes.
So, unfortunately, like some of you, I will not apologize for speaking a foreign language. And I will also not apologize for speaking my own language. And I won't because I cannot. By some unjustifiable rule, I am not allowed to speak my own language in my own country in a public institution funded by Brazilian citizens. In response to this prohibition, I offer proposals. I invite you all to follow the English text in the Book of Abstracts, and also to allow yourselves to follow the Portuguese version of the text that will be projected on this wall. Maybe then I could possibly convince you to replace prohibition rules for creative communication strategies, as well as give you a little experience of the country you are visiting. Thank you. So we begin with Euripides Bacchae, Lice Mota Monotos, Hotam Ego Ego. No? The God Himself will release me whenever I want. So, Plato's Phaedo is the groundwork for philosophical discussion on suicide, a most urgent philosophical problem in times of assisted euthanasia laws and suicide bombers. The text presents two analogies: the body as a sentinel and human beings as God's possessions. This is 62b38. You'll have the Greek passage there. I'm not reading, I think that after a week you know them all by heart. So these two analogies form the basis of theistic arguments against suicide in Augustine and Aquinas, and also as we saw today in Philo. So the Phaedo also introduces an exception clause to this general rule. Until God send us a necessity like the one now put upon us. That's the passage 62c 7-8. This exceptional clause was interpreted by philosophers such as Epictetus and Olympiodorus as a defense of suicide justified by special circumstances. So, the aim of this paper is to argue that Plato Phaedo depicts Socrates' death as a rational suicide, justified not by circumstances, but by a strict conception of the self. So I set myself to answer four questions. First, how can Plato's account on Socrates' death be considered a suicide? Second, how can Socrates forbid suicide in general and consider his suicide moral? Three, why was Socrates' suicide rational? Four, why is Socrates' suicide not a kind of suicide justified by circumstances? So first, Socrates' death was a suicide. Well, suicide is a polemical philosophical concept, as you might know. Spinoza, for example, has shown it to be an inconsistent concept, for it implies a deceptive duplication of oneself. I'll come back to Spinoza later. The problem of the self is important here for the argument I want to give. So in order to counter-argument Spinoza and grant a consistent concept, I suggest a more restricted definition of suicide. For the purpose of this paper, suicide is defined as an intentional act in which the agent produces the causes of his own death. At first sight, this may seem incompatible with the main circumstances of Socrates' death, the execution of a death penalty. However, as the Crito 44c 3-7, you have the passage there, and the Phaedo 98e 5-99a 4, both show death was not his only alternative. Besides, as Plato's Apology 32b5e1 testifies, civil disobedience had already been Socrates' choice at least twice in his life. Moreover, the Phaedo does not focus on the injustice of the death penalty. It rather emphasizes Socrates' extraordinary serenity and how his end was fearless and noble. This is 58e45. As I am about to argue, Plato's focus in this dialogue is Socrates' eudaimonia and death. Point two, Socrates' suicide is moral. Socrates' point against suicide in the beginning of the dialogue refers specifically to the case in which violence to oneself is involved, and that's passage 61d4. Important. The controversial passage 62a1-5, in which Socrates supposedly says that prohibition of suicide is a law to all human beings without exception, once carefully understood, actually states that human beings are not allowed to commit suicide, quote, without the external intervention of a benefactor. This is 62a7. An agent who will turn killing into an act of piety. As long as suicide is based on the necessity sent by the god, this is 62c7, it is not a homicide, at least as homicide is described in 62c4. because its purpose is not destructive. It's not an act of violence, as we saw in 62.1.d4, but rather a benefit to the killed. Socrates' death, as one moment of his usual obedience to the god, as we can see in this 85b, is about the swans, shall not be considered impious or immoral. The justification for this apparent paradox is to be found in Socrates' understanding of death. Death, according to Plato's Phaedo, is separation of body and soul in two senses. As an immediate act, the phenomenon of death, this is 64c45, and as a process of distinction, the exercise of death, 67d45. The connection between these two senses is not metaphorical. It is based on a very specific concept of death as the accomplishment of one's true self through separation. In his final hypothetical approach, Socrates defined the body as essentially dead and accidentally alive. That means its essence is to be found in death. That's 106e46. On the other hand, the soul is essentially life, and accidentally the agent through which the body participates in the form of life, 165-6. In identifying himself with the soul, Socrates' claims throughout the Phaedo are that his death is not his destruction. This is 115-6, 116-81. It's not even the destruction of his body, which will remain, we know that, 64c56. So dying is the preservation of self-identity of these two substances. Many were the critics who saw this kind of argument as absurd. Dorter, for example, concludes, the arguments are equal fallacious, since their principle assumes the presence of an attribute after the substance has ceased to exist. In response, I would say that the Phaedo denies this notion of an individual as a substance of attributes, and defends an identity constituted by a set of attributes that are non-corporeal. The self as a kind of hexis that is preserved even when the composite individual ceases to exist. The problem of the self is therefore both an epistemological and a practical challenge in human life. To discover our true being requires rigorous intellectual examination and the acquisition of phronesis. This is 65b-5 and then 65a-9. So phronesis, that means a psychological state, a hexis, a disposition in which we cease to err and rest on our own identity. That's 79d4. Described as the only true virtue, because it promotes indifference to death by eliminating fear and desire, phronesis is a disposition in which the two substances, body and soul, have already been separated in a human being, and I call your attention to Kekataf Menos at 69c6. In arguing that Socrates' death was a moral suicide, I claim that because of his phronesis, it's not violent. It does not destroy the body, and does not threat his permanent disposition, the Socratic self. The divine necessity presented in Socrates' death, I claim, is his phronesis. The fact that he is a true vacant and not a mere thyrsus bearer. Or in other words, the fact that he knows who he is and that he is who he is. And that's about the vacant epigraph. So point three, the suicide is rational. Before we proceed, it is important to dismiss the impression that Socrates' suicide was a choice of pure religious fanaticism. There is abundant evidence in the Phaedo that the acknowledgement of the necessity sent by God must be a rational act. For instance, Socrates claims that it is not reasoning. Socrates claims that it is in reasoning that reality becomes manifest, and also that mythology is the worst enemy to be fought. He also says that whatever he does is based on a rational choice about what is best. The strict notion of self-identity as a permanent disposition we discussed in the previous section is not enough to justify Socrates' decision to die. It does not prevent him to go on living as the person he was, indifferent if he was dead or alive. Could be indifferent. So his rational motivation for the act of suicide is to be found in his understanding of causality, aitia, and agent responsibility, aitia. For Socrates, the real aitia is an account that justifies what is best for something to exist, to come to being, or to perish, in 697, C61. That means a cause is what accounts for being qua its best disposition. This is 98. On the other hand, the agent truly responsible for some effect, some effect, the aition, is the one without which there would be no responsibility. That is 99b, 3-4. Socrates clearly does not agree with the headsman who has a quote in the dialogue, and who says that the rulers are the ones responsible for his death. That is 116c7. In his view, what happened was that the Athenians did what seemed to them to be the best to do, and Socrates did what seemed to him to be the best to do. Both agents decide according to what they thought it was best, and they were both responsible for their choice. Up to this point, there could still be doubts in describing Socrates' death as a death penalty or a suicide. But Socrates does not leave things there. He presents himself as the agent who decided to die, this is 99b1, and not simply to place his muscles and bones in the ocean. That is 98E5, 99A1. If the account on causes in the Phaedo aims at specifying what is the major factor responsible for an event, it concludes that the decision of the Athenians was a concurrent factor, a synaitia, and Socrates was the ultimate responsible agent for his own death. Socrates justifies his choice based on justice and beauty. That's 99A2-4. That means if real causes describe what is best for an entity, if human beings aim at what is best for them, dying was the best for Socrates to be. Fourth point, Socrates' suicide is not justified by circumstances. Suicide justified by circumstances is a rational choice between future prospects possible in a specific moment of life. The most relevant example of this case of suicide can be found in Xenophon's Apology, 6.1, 7.3, according to which Socrates decides to die because old age would make living not worth it. Some interpreters understood Plato's point in the Phaedo to be the same as Xenophon's, and they read the Ananke sent by the gods as a case of suicide in circumstance of coercion, very similar to the one defended and performed by Seneca. So that is a suicide in which misfortune presses for a specific decision about the value of life. However, we cannot fail to notice that in the Phaedo, Socrates describes his present situation as not one of misfortune. This is 84b1. Neither can we dismiss Socrates' distinction between courage facing death, doing to cowardice, or doing to phronesis. This is 68d2e1. In his defense of true virtue, Socrates claims that the choice for death, justified by fear of a greater evil, is false courage. This is 69b5c3. The real cause of the moral suicide cannot be relief of pain, the unworthiness of life, or any other fear. Socrates' moral suicide will therefore not allow any escapist argument, and it shall not be attributed to coercive circumstances. Socrates' suicide was a choice based on arguments about the self. I opened this paper mentioning Spinoza's thesis in which the description of suicide in which the description of the suicide as self-killing is metaphysically impossible for implying a false duplication of oneself. Spinoza claims that the desire of self-killing cannot come from the essence of the agent that kills. Plato's Phaedrus agrees with Spinoza to the extent that the destruction of the self is impossible, and that in this description, suicide would be a logical mistake. However, Plato's Phaedo presents a different description of suicide as the soul's decision to distinguish itself from the body. This particular description was the reason why we began with a more prudent concept of suicide, in which death was not described as destruction, in which the agent causation played an important role. So against Spinoza, Socrates provides a much more reasonable description of the act of suicide as separation, while still claiming that the killing of the self is impossible. Moreover, in identifying the self with the soul, Socrates can give an account of suicide that is not pathological, neither in the sense of an acratic ruling of passions over reason, nor in the medical sense that we today tend to classify attempts of suicide. This last point. It is Socrates' concept of the self that marks the similarity of the Phaedo as an extraordinary death scene. And a good conclusion for it would be Sciorron's famous quote, "Le suicide est le paroxysme de la salut." Socrates' happiness reflects the integrity of his notion of the self, which is independent of his body. This, of course, answers Nietzsche's wrong assumption that Plato's Phaedo depicts how Socrates considers his life a disease. Both his life and his death were completely healthy. Thank you.
Merci beaucoup à Caroline Arapujo pour son analyse très stimulante du dialogue que l'interprète dans le comité interprété en considérant donc la mort de Socrate comme un suicide rationnel. Je pense que sur ce point-là, il y aura probablement une discussion très vivante. Et donc je donne la parole tout de suite à Franco Trabattoni.
Good for your analysis. I think that I can agree with you, but the only problem I have is on the notion of suicide in itself. Because I think that one can speak about suicide only if someone made some action, violent action against himself, make some violent action, fa qualche commette qualche azione violenta. Commette qualche azione violenta contro se stesso, perché che Socrate potesse non morire è chiaro, ma se ogni volta che qualcuno potendo non morire sceglie di morire fosse un suicidio, tutti quelli che si sacrificano per la patria, per i parenti, per gli amici sarebbero dei suicidi. sottrarsi alla morte per ragioni morali, secondo me, perché se tutti i mezzi che aveva a disposizione per sottrarsi alla morte erano per lui moralmente inaccettabili, per esempio anche per non disubbidire al Dio, come hai detto tu. Anche questo potrebbe essere una ragione morale. Poteva fuggire, poteva ascoltare quello che gli ha detto il rettore, poteva fuggire anche l'ultimo giorno, no? Poteva difendersi meglio, dicendo portare i figli in tribunale, no? Come tanti facevano, non l'ha fatto. Dunque, secondo me, non voleva suicidarsi, non voleva commettere ingiustizia. E dunque, dei due, cioè, poteva sopravvivere solo commettendo ingiustizia. Questo per dire, ma che la tua analisi può andare tutta accettabile, secondo me. L'unico punto è proprio questo. Se questo è un suicidio, Leonida si è suicidato. Leonida, lo spartano Leonida alla Termopili si è suicidato. Sono quelli che, se sei d'accordo, proprio di termini. Il suicidio quando uno dice che fa qualcosa contro di sé e si toglie la vita, non accetta di morire per una causa. Questo non è un suicidio.
Dunque, credo che ci sono, in quello che ha detto, ci sono due criteri. Il primo che ha menzionato è la violenza.
Violenza, anche non violenza,
però,
basta il veleno. Non volevo dire violenza.
E dunque, il problema è, secondo te il suicidio non è un atto violento?
No, un atto positivo contro di sé può essere lasciarsi morire, non mangiare più. Non è detto che sia violenza, ma un atto positivo contro. Un atto positivo contro se stesso,
sì.
Che può essere o violento o no, non è questo, ma
sì.
non semplicemente dire non parlo in tribunale, dunque mi lascio condannare a morte, questo non è un suicidio.
Dunque il problema non è la violenza, e dunque secondo te il problema è fare un atto contro se stesso. Sì.
Scusami se parlo sempre, ma il caso è proprio questo. Scusate, l'ultima cosa. Questo caso, uno in tribunale dice non ti uccidiamo se tu riveli i nomi dei tuoi complici, lui non li rivela, viene ucciso. È un suicidio, sì o no?
È questo che ho provato a dire, che ci sono ragioni diverse per il suicidio. E dunque, se io ho una ragione per fare un'azione contro me stesso, e questo in modo generale qualifica un suicidio. Quello che tu hai detto è che ha ragioni migliori e ha ragioni peggiori. Questo che è il martirio, per esempio, o qualcosa così. Però a lì questo mi pare un problema, perché è questo che vuole dire, che questo è un suicidio morale. È un suicidio basato e una ragione morale forte. Ma io sono d'accordo che come si qualifica il suicidio, che questo è il primo problema, e questo è un problema generale anche oggi si dibatte, molto dibattuto. Però sì, come penso io, il suicidio è un atto contro se stesso che causa la sua propria morte. E questo, e Socrate dice che lui, questo è quello che lui ha voluto e lui ha deciso, questo è il testo, dunque io non vedo perché non comprende. Ma c'è un punto, e io credo che hai una grande resistenza a discutere il suicidio. Io credo che il suicidio non è un male senza.
Je vous invite à la trilogia la più totale, Andrea Capra, no?
Cerco di essere brachilogico. Forse ti porto un po' fuori tema, ma volevo chiederti come interpreti la parte conclusiva del secondo discorso di Socrate nell'Apologia, dopo che rivendica naturalmente tutte le ragioni per cui dovrebbe essere fatto oggetto di premi e non di punizioni dallo Stato. Alla fine, proprio le ultimissime parole che dice, sono quelle in cui sostanzialmente accetta di pagare denaro offerto dai loro amici, dai suoi amici, per non morire sostanzialmente. Come rientra questo nel quadro che hai tracciato?
Io credo che tutto questo scenario giudiziario dell'apologia torna molto difficile fare questo argomento sul suicidio. Io credo che questo argomento c'è pure semplicemente nel pedone. E per questo diceva che il pedone è così fino a oggi il primo testo con una riflessione filosofica sul suicidio. E che ci sono, e dopo ci sono le leggi, ma nei due testi Platone indicano che regole generali per il suicidio, che non va bene, e eccezioni nelle cui va bene. E credo che è interessante se pensiamo in questo senso, però credo che nell'apologia questo non si...
Sì.
Capina, eu não sei se eu entendi bem a sua definição de suicídio, provavelmente não. Mas eu gostaria de saber se suicídio sendo definido em linhas gerais como envolvendo a seguinte proposição de que o agente produz as causas de sua própria morte, como você disse, eu gostaria de saber se, por exemplo, Martin Luther King, Malcolm X e Chico Mendes foram suicidas.
Foram assassinados, né?
Inclusive sem passar por nenhum tipo de processo legal. O Sócrates foi condenado pelo
Estado. Deixa eu só fazer um ponto. O problema central do Fédon é que Sócrates escolhe. Há uma deliberação sobre isso. Então, let me rephrase it in another language. The problem was if all people who were killed because of defending some dangerous cause were also suicides, and I'm just answering that. According to me, these are not suicides because they didn't decide to do so. And I think the strong claim that the Phaedo presents is that Socrates decided to do so.
Alors, vraiment, 15 secondes pour la question et 30 pour la réponse. Fernando.
I will adopt the language strategy proposed by Carolina. Vou adotar a proposta de linguagem proposta da Carolina. I think your idea of suicide is too much large, because I think it englobes annihilation of himself and both preservation of himself. Então eu a minha crítica à Carolina, depois da belíssima exposição que ela fez, de ter talvez ampliado o conceito de suicídio, não apenas para o aniquilar-se a si mesmo, mas também ao preservar-se a si mesmo. Porque toda a exposição dela mostrou como o suicídio, entendido dessa maneira, é um modo de preservar-se. E aí é que talvez preservar-se não seja de fato a mesma coisa que aniquilar-se. E o suicídio talvez possa ficar restrito ao aniquilar.
Well, listen, I think that's the point. I mean, what I'm claiming that suicide, as the Plato Phaedus agrees with Spinoza that suicide is illogical concept in the sense that it doesn't involve the annihilation of itself. That's the difference I was making between the act of suicide and the metaphysical concept of suicide. And in the metaphysical, so that's why Socrates can say, I'm dying to preserve myself. And that's what makes the suicide moral and rational. So it is the act that we call suicide is there because he decided to do so. But the reason why he describes the act is the preservation of the self.
Professora Alexandre Moraes. Caroline, je demande, je vais poser une première question. Je demande si on peut penser la mort de Socrate seulement par le Criton, parce que si on pense au Criton, il meurt parce qu'il doit obéir aux lois. Et aux lois démocratiques de l'Athènes, même s'il critique les principes de la démocratie. C'est l'ambiguïté du Criton. Donc, s'il pense qu'il doit obéir à la loi avant tout, et par la loi il a été condamné, comment on peut penser un suicide?
Então, é o seguinte. No Criton, o problema do suicídio não fica claro no Criton. Por quê? Porque ali não está claro que Sócrates está escolhendo. Então, mas tem um problema aqui no Criton que eu vejo que acho que contribui para a tese. É de que o Sócrates decide não fazer. E ele decide fazer por obediência, sendo que na apologia o Sócrates... Platão, na apologia, o Sócrates por duas vezes comete desobediência civil. Então, por que, que agora ele resolve obedecer se na outra, nos outros momentos ele não desobedece? Agora, o outro ponto que é, assim, para o Xenofonte é claríssimo que o Sócrates queria morrer.
Marcelo Boeri. It's very, very, very. You mentioned in passing a couple of times in your paper, very elegant presentation.
Which passage? I didn't understand the passage. Which passage?
You mentioned in passing a couple of times, at least in your very elegant presentation, that Socrates' decision, you talk about Socrates' decision to die. My point is very simple. To die was not his decision. His ascension probably was just to continue to be a very coherent person. Yes. Of course, this implied his death.
Exactly.
Right. Okay, but that's it. Thank you.
That's what I'm calling rational suicide. And I'm really willing to go into that, to start looking at suicide in a way that preserve people's self.
Complimenti per il tuo coraggio di dire sul suicidio di Socrate, però penso che è stato troppo in avanti, sia andata troppo in avanti. Penso che Socrate ha deciso morire, non suicidarsi. E vorrei dire che se volendo intendere il tuo approccio, io avrei detto che chissà, come Fedone è una creazione di Platone, non dimentichiamo mai di questo, no? Cioè Platone, non, Platone crea un dialogo, e se non si può mettere insieme la città, cioè è un suicidio non solo di Socrate ma pure della polis, perché lui ha deciso di seguire la polis, e qui faccio un'approssimazione col Critone, dove le leggi proprio dicono Socrate, noi gli abbiamo dato la vita.
Non credo che una città può essere, può uccidere, però. Ma un ultimo punto. Io credo che nella presentazione del suicidio c'è 72b. Il testo è molto chiaro, ci sono, non possiamo commettere suicidio perché questo, però in questa circostanza qui possiamo. È Platone che pensa il suicidio così, è Platone che dice che Socrates fa un suicidio Teni remi paruso. E credo e le leggi anche suggeriscono questo, che ci sono suicidi che sono morali, che non sono violenti.
Désolé pour le retard, mais la discussion a été très très vivante et passionnante, donc la braculovia n'a pas été trop respectée. Je suis très heureux de présenter Eli Diamond, qui est professeur associé de philosophie ancienne au Department of Classics and Philosophy à la Dalhousie University in Canada. Et ses recherches concernent surtout Platon et Aristote. Je vais mentionner son livre très important sur les De Anima, Mortal Limitations of Divine Life, The Nature of the Soul in Aristotle's De Anima. Il a aussi écrit plusieurs articles sur Platon, par exemple sur le Diphron, Parallel Trials, The Dramatic Structure of Plato's Euthyphro in the Classical Quarterly. Actuellement, à ce moment, il est en train donc de publier une nouvelle édition du Banquet de Platon, et il est en train de développer une recherche financée par le Conseil des recherches en sciences humaines du Canada, intitulée Political Ontology and Ontological Politics, Metaphysics and Politics in Ancient Greek Philosophy. Je lui donne donc tout de suite la parole. Il nous parlera donc de Pythagorean Mathematics, Platonic Dialectic and Incompleteness of the Second Sailing in Plato's Phaedo. Thank you very much. Merci beaucoup.
Merci beaucoup et à tous ceux et celles qui ont survécu jusqu'à la dernière communication parallèle. Merci de votre fortitude. Okay, je vais commencer. Why does Plato give his dialogue Phaedo a Pythagorean framework with three significant characters identified as students of Philolaus? He makes doubly clear that the dialogue is specifically addressed towards the Pythagorean in Socrates' argument. Besides the Pythagorean identity of the main characters, it's also widely accepted that several of the positions argued by Socrates in the dialogue have a Pythagorean origin. The immortality and transmigration of the soul, the view of the body as a prison for the soul from which it must be freed through purification. Noting this strange connection between Pythagorean content in Socrates' position and the Pythagorean identity of his chief interlocutors, David Sedley has drawn attention to what he calls, I quote, the paradoxical spectacle of Socrates having to convince the Pythagoreans of the truth of their own doctrine. But this spectacle appears less paradoxical, I argue, when one identifies just what kind of Pythagoreans Plato is depicting in this dialogue. I want to build on the interpretations of Gadamer, House, Horky, who see in these Pythagoreans mathematically oriented philosophers whose strong skepticism demands rational, demonstrative arguments as proof of anything they believe, and for whom the religious beliefs of older Pythagoreanism have lost their interest. Put in terms of the development of Pythagorean philosophy, Cibes, Simmias, and Echecrates are mathematicoi, who expect demonstrative arguments and explanations for everything, and consequently have lost any meaningful connection to the religious and ethical doctrines of the akousmatikoi. So one central purpose of the discussion in Phaedo is to philosophically ground older Pythagorean religious beliefs about the soul in a way that would satisfy this new generation of Pythagorean philosophers and their rigorous demand for rational, necessary argumentation as a condition for trusting anything. So when explaining the meaning of the Pythagorean context of Phaedo, it's crucial to recognize in Plato's writing, I quote Burkert, that for Plato, foreign material is no longer foreign, but an integral part of the Platonic structure. And following Sedley, the dramatis personae of the Phaedo must therefore be read as symbolic. But symbolic of what? Plato here uses the Pythagorean position held by Philolaus and his followers to symbolize, I suggest, a view that takes mathematical objects, numbers, geometrical shapes, ratios, etc., as the fundamental causes or archi of sensible existence, and who elevate mathematical thinking as the fundamental causes or archive, elevates mathematical thinking and its emphasis on demonstrative proof as the highest way that we can grasp the world. So the key Platonic structure which unlocks this symbolism of the Pythagorean context of Phaedo, I want to suggest can be thought through the divided line in Republic 6. Expressed according to the distinctions we find there articulated on the line, Socrates' goal in the Phaedo can be understood as convincing these mathematical philosophers operating at the level of dianoia that the mere beliefs trusted by the religious Pythagoreans on authority through pistis or doxa could actually be known by thought. Socrates' strategy for showing them the truth of older Pythagorean religious views of the soul is not to encourage them to abandon their rational skepticism and the authority of reason and to retreat back to religious pistis, but rather to deepen their skepticism so as to elevate their rational thinking to new heights. Pythagorean religious belief at the level of pistis can be grounded only if one rises beyond mathematical dianoia to dialectical noesis of supra-mathematical forms and their ultimate arche, nous. So if Pythagorean mathematicians can be converted into full-blooded Platonists, they could apprehend the truths of older Pythagorean beliefs about the immortality of the soul. This is why Pythagorean mathematicoi are the ideal participants for this discussion about the soul's immortality. With just mere hours before his death, Socrates could never establish that the soul's thinking activity operates independently of its necessarily embodied activities, unless he can begin from a position which already recognizes the existence of eternal and unchanging objects of thought, which are grasped by a thinking activity distinct from bodily sense perception. The extent to which the mind and its objects are not only distinct from the sensible, but actually exist independently, auto katauto, and apart from our bodily involvement, is at the center of determining the question of whether the soul in fact survives in separation from the body in death. So if this interpretation is plausible, we should be able to see in Cibes and Simmias' perspectives both the strengths and the weaknesses of mathematical dianoia. That is, both why they are the ideal addressees of the argument, and why nonetheless the argument must move them beyond the limits of their position. Now remember, in Republic, Socrates identifies two chief deficiencies in the dianoetic grasp of mathematical objects. First, while the truth of mathematics are conceptual and eternal, mathematical thinking relies on sensible models and pictures for its proofs. Implied here is that the mathematical objects themselves do not have total ontological separability and independence from sensible extension. Now, in contrast, dialectical noesis requires, remember, no reference to sensible pictures. Just as the thinking itself is purely conceptual reflection on ideas and their interrelations, the objects of this thinking, the forms, the good, nous, have a complete independence from their sensible expression. The second point he makes in Republic, mathematical thinking lays down hypotheses as certain axioms without investigating or explaining why they exist as they do, and then reasons deductively from these unquestioned axioms towards conclusions. It moves from hypotheses towards conclusions as opposed to upward towards an arche. Examples of this hypothetical and deductive thinking are geometry and arithmetic. In contrast, dialectical noesis does not treat any hypothesis as certain or self-explanatory, moving not deductively to conclusions, but upwards to more universal and fundamental forms stopping only once it can reach a genuinely unhypothetical principle. So the first limitation of mathematical dianoia helps to explain what should seem like a strange ambiguity in Sibbes and Simmias's position. On the one hand, they easily, instantly, accept the distinction between the soul and the body, thinking and sensation, the superiority of these, of the former over the latter. They also accept, without argument, the existence of intelligible forms, the just itself, the beautiful itself, the good itself, meekness itself, etc. And these forms are the usia of the sensible instances of each. And to think about how these could be so quickly accepted by non-Platonic, pre-Platonic mathematical Pythagoreans. Just think about Aristotle's testimony about the Pythagorean numbers for justice, for soul, for mind, and opportunity. On the other hand, they cannot conceive of the superiority of the soul over the body as entailing the independence of the soul from the body. But far from being materialists, as they're sometimes pretended to be, they see the principles and causes as being intelligible and not sensible, but they don't think that the intelligible is altogether separable from the sensible. That this belongs to understanding the intelligible soul according to mathematical form is clear enough through Simmias's embrace of the view of soul as the harmony or ratio of bodily elements. In another way, it's also evidenced by the explicit dependence of both Simmias and Sibbes in their objections to Socrates on sensible images when they're articulating their own view of the soul, a lyre and its strings, a cloak and its cloakmaker. It belongs to mathematical thinking to require such sensible examples and to view the intelligible causes of things not to be completely separable from their sensible embodiment. I skip just a paragraph. When the Phaedo is viewed in this way as Socrates' attempt to bring his Pythagorean friends from mathematical dianoia to dialectical noesis and from math objects to forms and nous, a remarkable feature of the dialogue emerges, which can help explain the explicit tentativeness and incompleteness of the final argument for the soul's immortality that we've referenced many times. And that's this. Socrates' own second best method proceeds according to the very weaknesses that belong to mathematical dianoia. In particular, simply laying down hypotheses, which are then treated as axiomatically unhypothetical. So on the one hand, the method he describes is clearly teleological, and it's clearly, I think, meant to have the free character of dialectical noesis, treating the forms not as unquestioned axioms, but as hypotheses demanding fuller and fuller explanations until one's thinking arrives at the unhypothetical principle of nous or the good, tihikanon. So just citing one passage, should you have to give an account of that hypothesis itself, you give it just the same way by hypothesizing in turn another hypothesis, whichever of the higher ones appeared best, until you came to something sufficient. Yet this is not how Socrates actually proceeds in his account of his method. Socrates explains that since he's blinded and he cannot look directly to nous, what would I think amount to the first best method, he must base his causal explanations on the separate forms as a second sailing or second best method. And the language in this section, as we've noticed, is striking for its emphasis on this as being a safe method, employed to flee from the great risk and danger out of fear. The language of safety comes, I suggest, from the mathematical practice of simply laying down a truth as necessary and not demanding further explanation for the moment, while the dialectical practice of treating hypotheses is genuinely risky. Socrates speaks over and over again of hypothesizing the form of the X in itself, and then clinging to it for safety, to avoid the indeterminacy of both the endlessly changing and multiple sensible and the blinding transcendence of mind, as well as the risky uncertainty of treating these hypotheses as genuinely hypothetical. He repeatedly asks his interlocutors to grant him, allow him that the forms exist, and that the sensibles get their name from these by participating in them, and then to proceed from these unproven, undiscussed assumptions. In other words, in the second best method, it is simply laid down that mind is the arche, that the forms are the intelligible determinations of mind, and that sensibles are what they are by virtue of their participation in form. Yet by burdening his philosophical method with the same limits that belong to mathematical theanoia, his own discussion is trying to surpass, I think Plato is indicating to us the direction the subsequent discussion must take. True dialectic cannot rest with the safety of the mathematical version of itself. It must risk becoming genuinely dialectical to give an account which explains that the form in question exists and why it exists. So after the failure of Socrates' attempt to understand the cause of natural and mathematical being in nature or in number, his second best method, I think, is thus what Simmias earlier characterized as adopting the best and most irrefutable of men's theories, and borne upon this, sail through the dangers of life as upon a raft. It's a human theory. It's not yet a divine logos, because it's not yet grounded in the divine nous, grasped as the unhypothetical cause of both the forms and the sensible participants. In contrast, genuine dialectical noesis, whose hypothetical, non-axiomatic investigation into forms should culminate in a grasp of the principle itself, I think is precisely the logos theos, which is ultimately the safest method, because the principle and cause one reaches is actually unhypothetical, not simply laid down as unhypothetical. So the reader who notices that Socrates' method is vulnerable to the same limits of axiomatic mathematical thinking he is trying to himself transcend can appreciate, then, why Socrates announces to Simmias at 107a8 that the hypothesis potas must be investigated and not simply trusted. That is, to move away from pistis and dianoia, the dialogue initiates, it must be now completed by purifying the second best method of dialectic of its mathematical residue, a move which must risk treating absolutely nothing as hypothetical unless it genuinely is unhypothetical. And I think only nous or the good ought to satisfy this highest standard. All right, I'll just skip ahead to the conclusion. To look forward to Paris in 2019. Perhaps the closest we get in the dialogues to the free and risky dialectic that treats hypotheses absolutely hypothetically is the daunting dialectical gymnastic in the second half of Plato's Parmenides. Such a way of proceeding would be excessive and inappropriate, however, to the occasion of the Phaedo, an apologia of Socrates' confidence in the face of death. We have seen instead that Socrates has tailored his argument to the mode of understanding of his Pythagorean audience. While the argument seeks to move his Pythagorean friends away from mathematical theanoia to Platonic noesis, Socrates does so perhaps out of expedience, perhaps out of rhetorical necessity, from within the limits of theanoia itself. Yet in pointing explicitly to the incompleteness of the argument of Phaedo, Plato has also laid us out a roadmap of where thinking must lead from this new standpoint. Thank you.
Merci beaucoup à Ilaï pour cette analyse très pointue qui se base sur une reconstruction très savante de l'arrière-plan philosophique et scientifique du Phaedon. Je pense qu'il y aura des questions, donc, professeur Altman.
Well, Levi, I'd like to kind of present my question in relation. I'd like to present my question in the form of the divided line. I'm going to pose you four questions. You choose just one. The first one is, when you describe the first, the method, noesis, as a hypothetical and non-axiomatic, I think you need to defend that. I mean, hypothetical maybe to start, but they got to get kicked out. So I'm not too comfortable with that as the description of noesis. Okay. And I'm not too comfortable with the now dianoia. So you could defend that if you want. Mm-hmm. And the other thing I'd like, you might want to consider defending, I wish I had your text, but it was the word universal. When you were talking about going up to higher and higher and more mm-hmm. universal mm-hmm. forms, I didn't like that.
Okay.
In the sense that, I mean, you know we're on the same page on this dianoia stuff, but I don't know that I would put it as more universal, and I wonder if you want to defend that. Mm-hmm. The next one is when you did the sun, now we're on the level of pistis, that was the second was the dianoid one, now we're down with the sun. And I'm curious about the way you used the word blinding, because on the one hand, you know, you got the metaphor of being blinded by the sun, but he's pretty explicit that you can be blinded by looking at sensible things. And I wondered if maybe I either misheard or that you are mixing the words blinding there, or if you want to defend that. So that's a third possibility you could do. Oh, and then the fine thing to descend to the realm of shadows. I wonder if you'd comment on Aristotle's view that Plato was most influenced by the Heracliteans and the Pythagoreans. So just pick one. I want to read.
Okay. Quickly. This one's quick. I think I actually take that passage in Phaedo to talk about a double blindness. That is, there's a blindness that was produced by his early inquiry into natural and mathematical explanations, and he fled from that blindness. But I also think he speaks of a blindness of looking, as Anaxagoras might have suggested, to nous, and then understanding the word through directly apprehending nous, and that's also impossible. And I was arguing that would be the first best method. The criticism of Plato, I think it is a criticism of Plato that he's pretty much saying the same thing as the Pythagoreans, Aristotle's involved in a kind of imminent critique at that point, because he's taking this kind of criticism of mathematical Pythagoreanism in the Phaedo and saying, if your principles are limit and unlimited, or the one and the dyad, those are Pythagorean principles. And what is produced out of those are not qualitatively defined forms, but quantitatively determined arithmoi. And so that's turning Plato against himself as a mode of criticism.
Thank you.
Yes, first, thank you. It was very interesting. I'm just wondering about dianoia. What mm-hmm. does it mean exactly? So on your view, in the Phaedo, Socrates remains in dianoia, in a dianoitic mode of explanation, because he doesn't give an account of the forms,
yes,
but he takes them as a hypothesis. Yeah. But if you go back to Republic 6, I think that what is precisely characteristic of dialectic is to take the form as yes. mere hypothesis, which is something Socrates insists here. You see, of course he doesn't give an account of the form, but he says they are mere hypotheses. Whereas the mathematicians, they take them as archai, and they don't even assume that they are things posited.
Yes.
So don't you think that we could say that Socrates in the Phaedo is in the first part of the dialectical process,
yes.
the ascent, and that the logon didonai is something which is not done in the dialogue, but which would be the final part of of dialectic.
Okay, so you've gotten exactly right to the center of what I'm saying. So that's one of the I'm grateful to clarify that. So what I'm saying is maybe a little bit overly subtle, but that that in a sense he's encouraging them to a dialectical noesis of the forms. But the way that he talks about the forms in the second best method has the characteristics of dianoia. That is, the forms are laid down as unexplained, I would use almost as axioms that he will follow through and derive conclusions from. And that although the ontological entities that he's talking about are the ones that noesis should grasp, the method of thinking that he's actually instantiating in the dialogue has more the characteristic of deductive dianoia. But by the fact that he says, we'll lay down this hypothesis, we're not going to look into it, we're going to just hang on to it for safety, and then move to our final argument.
Oui. Alors, donc, il y a beaucoup de choses, je vous ai parlé, mais il n'y a pas de temps, donc je me concentre seulement sur une ou deux questions. C'est-à-dire, le dit canon du texte que oui. Tu as cité, en fait, on m'a déjà posé la même question, Lloyd Guest, il y a deux jours. Et donc, il y a, et bon, j'ai trouvé, il y a un article de David Blank, c'est-à-dire, l'article, c'est à bout de titre, c'est 1996. L'article David Blank, excusez-moi, je vais le trouver. Socrates instruction to Kibes, Plato Fido, 101, etc. Et dans cet article, il montre que Tika, non, ce n'est pas la réponse de cet homme. C'est quelque chose qui c'est une question de rhétorique à l'intérieur du discours entre Socrates et Bess. C'est quelque chose qui est suffisant à persuader. Après, on pourrait dire qu'il s'agit bien de la hypothétique, évidemment. Mais dans le. Je ne sais pas s'il a raison, selon moi, il a raison, mais évidemment, il faut prendre compte de ce que ce n'est pas évident une connexion entre le dit Icanon du. D'autant plus que Icanon, ça a souvent un sens de relativité. Icanon, pourquoi?
Pourquoi, okay.
Pourquoi? Et deuxième question, et je ne crois pas. Et en fait, il y a la Nipocéton dans la République et Platon a bien compris le fait que les hypothèses vont montrer, pas seulement accepter, discuter. Et donc, et l'objectif, c'est effectivement de trouver quelque chose qui est à Nipocéton. Mais ce n'est pas clair s'il y a vraiment quelque chose, si on peut vraiment arriver jusque-là.
Oui.
Et donc, je ne crois pas qu'il y a une sorte, je ne sais pas si c'est votre idée, donc je ne suis pas sûr, s'il y a une possibilité de réécrire le dernier argument du point de vue de la noésis. Je ne suis pas sûr.
Okay.
Il y a réellement cette possibilité.
Mm-hmm. Alors, oui, vous avez bien saisi, j'ai la même interprétation du Tihadikanon que Gerson. Et c'est parce que je trouve le passage est tellement semblable à ce qu'on trouve dans la République à 101 des 5, ou 1, j'ai la traduction anglaise ici. And should you have to give an account of that hypothesis itself, you give it in just the same way by hypothesizing and turn another hypothesis out of whichever of the higher ones appeared best until you came to Tihikanon. Alors, c'est la similitude entre les deux descriptions de la méthode qui m'a mené vers cette interprétation, mais c'est sûr que c'est peut-être une interprétation un peu surdéterminée. Oui. Ça va. Okay. Merci beaucoup.
Thank you, Eli, for your talk. I agree with so much of it, and that's why I think I can ask a question from almost like inside of it, that if we think of the dialogue of the Phaedo as constructed, we have this, Plato has this amazing moment, right? Socrates is dead, and he can use sort of historical material to a certain extent, but it's a little bit disappointing to think of it as Socrates engaging with mathematicians, Pythagoreans. You know, where's the A-team? Where's Plato? Where's Adamantus? Where's Glaucon? You know, it's just, it seems like, here's this moment, Socrates is dying. And so this is a question I ask myself. I mean, the one thing that I can point to something similar is at the end of the symposium, where Socrates just goes along his day. And this is somewhat similar, where it's just like, he just happened to be with these Pythagoreans and he's gonna spend his last days kind of having a discussion about math in their terms, but it's still a little bit of a letdown of the soul in mathematics.
I think you're underestimating the beauty and strength of mathematics on a Platonic view and in general. I think that insofar as they are mathematical, if that's right, this is actually a higher standpoint than most of the interlocutors that we find in the dialogue. And as I put it this way, this dialogue would have to be a lot longer if you were talking with people who had not yet made the distinction between the intelligible and the sensible and realized that the intelligible is constituted of eternal, unchanging principles. They are on the doorstep of Platonism in a way that most interlocutors in the dialogues are not. So,
I agree with you on that point.
Yeah.
The problem is, it's like, there, it feels like an ethical discussion is somewhat missing.
I think what I'm saying is that he sees the strength of the religious and ethical content of the older and original Pythagoreanism and wants to return the mathematicians to the fullness of the Pythagorean position. Yeah.
Okay. Alors, merci beaucoup à nos orateurs, merci beaucoup à vous tous qui nous avez assisté à la dernière séance. Au revoir à Paris.